problem, we can avoid them giving medications for lifelong. And quality of life is much better. So, in they did not take any break from their working place. Those who are on medication, maybe you would have seen many patients, if they once psychiatry develops, they cannot concentrate on any work. So they have to force to the hospital to get rid of this problem. So this is definitely quality of life improves and saves their lives. Some of the medical arrhythmia which I showed, it's going to save their life. In the VF and VTF patients, it's going to save the AFib with the pre-exhalation. It's a life-threatening problem can be completely curable. And cost of the care, if you put together the lifelong recurrent hospitalization, going to the emergency, staying for one day and getting medications, recurrent admissions. So if you put together this ablation, not very costly one, it's one-time treatment, it's a curable treatment. So this finishes the tachy part. I'll two slides, I will show the bradi part, which is abnormally slow heartbeat, that is less than 50 per minute. Again, these patients also have the presentation, something differs. This patient mostly presented with the syncope or pre-syncope, loss of consciousness. Transient loss of consciousness, then they recover promptly. Sometimes vague, giddiness, dizziness, fatigue, because of low heart rate, they may not able to work. They feel always fatigue. And heart failure sometimes, shortness of breath, excess intolerance, because heart rate is not going up as they exercise. So the muscle get fatigue, they feel tiredness, not able to do their work. Again, same, we can do the same history. History is again important. Is some of the patients, elderly patient takes beta blockers or calcium channel blockers, which can reduce the rate. So that should be ruled out. So what patient medication they are taking, that should be taken care of, and especially unusual bradycardia, if you see what patient already is on, but especially those are hypertension, taking some medication. So you can rule out that possibility. And ECG is of course, routine investigation we should do. And Holter recording, again, so if it is intermittent, any AV blocks or anything, on that particular 24 hours, if it gives, it's okay. If it doesn't give, then it's not going to rule out any problem. So you may have to proceed further for electrophysiology study if you are suspecting anything. So the two main causes for bradycardia, which we are all aware, one is electricity is produced from the sinus node. If there is any problem in the sinus node, then you may get problem. There is, it may present like sinus bradycardia, or maybe just sudden arrest, it will not produce any impulse, it will be a long process. Sometimes it goes into bradycardia, turns into tachycardia, that is bradytachy syndrome. And if you put the patient on a treadmill, the heart rate will not accelerate. So this is called chronotrophic incompetence. So these are the ways the patient present to you in the surface ECG. Or you may, surface ECG may show only sinus bradycardia. If you connect the Holter, you will see some process, long process, sometimes tachy, sometimes brady. All these things you can see in the Holter. Other common, which you all know, acute AV blocks. First degree, Mobitz type 1 also no problem. Only type 2 and advanced blocks produce symptoms. Some of the patient may not be symptomatic, only their fatigue or things. Some patients come to you with the syncope. These are common. Third degree AV block, we come across patient, come to the emergency with the recurrent syncopes. So we may have to do emergency pacemaker. So what is the, I would like to highlight, what is the natural history? Some of the arguments, some people argue that patient is asymptomatic, why do you want to treat these patients? What is the natural history? But natural history doesn't favor that. Only in mortality, the transient complete heart block is 36%. If you put the pacemaker, the life is equal to normal patient. So if the asymptomatic patient also, the asymptomatic congenital complete block is something different. In adult patient, complete heart block, transient CHV, the mortality is high. I will show the example. This gentleman, 35-year-old male, presented to us just breathlessness and giddiness on exertion. The Holter showed complete heart block. Not very wide equivalence, it's a relatively narrow equivalence, but you can see that there is a complete AV dissociation. When the Holter was on, he developed this polymorph VT, got arrested. So this is how the polymorph VT, when there is an extreme bradycardia, the bradycardia itself can precipitate arrhythmia. There is bradyinduced polymorph VT, torsades. So the long short sequence occurs after a long pause, there is a short coupling occurs, it's very close to the T wave, it creates polymorphic VT. This is how the patient dies of complete heart block patient. So this not complete heart block, not all safe. It just because patient is asymptomatic, it's not going to be remain asymptomatic entire life. So one should carefully study the patient who needs response. So the threshold for putting pacemaker, especially in elderly patient, should be low. So the treatment which you all know. So common thing is some practitioners put allopurinol for medications which is not going to help in long run. So the pacemaker therapy is the treatment for this bradyarrhythmias, either single chamber, dual chamber, that has to be selected according to the patients. In our country, it's a deciding factor, is measured as the affordability. So not only implanting pacemaker that many people implant, the main thing, there's a lot of advancement that happened in the pacemaker in the last decade. So it's very important to select particular model of pacemaker for the given patient. So the physician should understand what are the options available in front of him in the technology. So it is not a simple burying one pacemaker and forget about that. So it's a lot of the newer things are available in the pacemaker. Titrate the pacemaker according to the patient needs. So not only implanting, it has to be followed up according to the patient's symptoms. It can be programmed and follow-up is very important. Is there any problem, the physician should be able to solve the problem also. For that, you should have better understanding with the treating the patient with the pacemaker, especially programming options you should be aware. The other option is other next category, sudden cardiac arrest, which I included because patients are dying sudden cardiac arrest because of arrhythmia. Almost 83% of due to VTVF or polymorphic VT. The problem in our country or our thing is people don't realize this terminology of sudden cardiac arrest at all. People deny that, people don't die suddenly. This within any patient having onset of symptoms, cardiac symptoms and dying within 1 hour, it's sudden cardiac arrest. It is very next to output all cancers. This is the mode of common mode of death across the world. So we should give importance. We should not in denial mode. Patient dies suddenly. So we should not wait for that. Once the arrest happens, very few patients can survive, especially in our level of emergency setup. So one should risk stratify them even before they get into sudden cardiac arrest. We should be able to find out in our practice who are likely to have this sudden cardiac arrest problem. What is the common etiology for this sudden cardiac arrest? 80% of them coronary artery disease. Lot of camps and lot of awareness programs are running to prevent coronary artery disease, if you are all aware. Another 15% is due to cardiomyopathy, like hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, arrhythmogenic right ventricular dysplasia, dilated cardiomyopathy, all these things put together. Other 5% other channelopathies, long QT syndrome, short QT syndrome, Brugada syndrome. There's a big list of sudden cardiac things are there. So these patients, certain things are manifested in the ECG. If you are not carefully looking at the ECG, we will miss that patient. Especially those patients, the family history of sudden cardiac arrest is there, or sudden cardiac death is there, and the surviving people are coming and consulting you. It needs very, very careful evaluation of that particular patient to rule out any such genetic or any other cardiomyopathies or any problem. So who are all high risk group in our population? Those already had MI and low ejection fraction and already documented ventricular tachycardia, these were very high risk to die suddenly. Those who already suffered one cardiac arrest, luckily survived, then they are very high likely to get into trouble again. And those who have ejection fraction less than 35%, those are again coming to high risk. Or any previous coronary event or high risk profile, high hypertension, diabetes. Sometimes the sudden cardiac arrest runs in families. Their first manifestation of acute coronary syndrome may be the sudden cardiac arrest. They develop chest pain, within less than 1 hour they develop VTVF, they die suddenly. It sometimes runs in family also. These are genetic markers are there. So these are the people, high risk people. So even the patient, which is the most important deciding factor, reduced LVEF, ejection fraction. Lot of patients will see my EF, what is my EF, doctor, what is my EF? You know that, people know that EF also. So EF is the most important predictor. There is nothing, no other investigation gives that much of identification. The EF is the most important, especially if the EF falls below 35%. It's a steep increase in the incidence of sudden cardiac arrest. So we should carefully evaluate this patient. It is irrespective, even the patient is underwent by angioplasty or coronary arrest, CABG, all these things. In spite of that, after the EF is low, is still, just because our population is after CABG, the stenting is over, they just forget, they just take the medication. But the EF remains low, 30-35%, they are still under high risk category for sudden cardiac arrest. And according to symptoms, who is likely to die suddenly? Not the patient who have very terribly symptomatic heart failure patients. Those are less symptomatic, class 2. 64% of the patient likely to die suddenly. Those who are less symptomatic likely to die suddenly, their first manifestation will be the sudden cardiac arrest. So those who are having breathlessness, repeated hospitalization, they die of heart failure, refractory heart failure and shock. Those who are doing very well, walking 2-3 kilometers, no symptoms, but EF is only 30%. Those who are the symptoms, maybe the sudden cardiac arrest. So the physician, the our problem with the physician always in a denial mode, even when a cardiologist, my patient is doing well, why I should bother them? It's not like that. So we need carefully to study with the patient to prevention of sudden cardiac arrest. Another concept is putting them on amiodarone. So amiodarone is not, lot of studies have proven that amiodarone is not, is a complete protection, it will have a long term, lot of toxicity effect. So we should consider other modalities. So in the programs, who are well documented risk factors, low EF, heart failure, especially low, like less symptomatic, like class 2, class 3 patients, post MI patients, already documented VT-VF patients. So irrespective of revascularization, if they have any VT-VF or a low EF, they are high risk candidate for sudden cardiac arrest. So the, what the way of things, those high risk candidates need device implantation. This is like a pacemaker, but it is something different. It has a shocking coils, this delivers shock. This device is called ICD, implantable cardioverter defibrillator, ICD, which continuously monitors the cardiac rhythm. If there is any abnormal rhythm, like the tachycardia rhythm, VT or ventricular tachycardia or ventricular fibrillation, it recognizes within a few seconds and terminates that. So by doing that, it saves the patient's life. It's like a routine pacemaker only we have to implant, but the device size is slightly bigger. So a few acute complications, mortality program is done under local anesthesia and is infracalcular region. According to the patient, we can select single chamber or dual chamber. It also comes to Mayo 5 years to maximum 9 to 10 years according to the usage of the battery. So only thing is slightly expensive, but the thing is patient needs, we should explain to the patient. So those, at least those who are affordable, we should not deny the patient just because we are patient is saying asymptomatic, we should not wait the first symptom of sudden cardiac arrest. So few slides about syncope. Again, the problem with the syncope is, again, we know it's a tachyarrhythmia or bradyarrhythmia, both can count syncope, there is loss of consciousness, which needs battery of investigation brought in from the ECG, treadmill, Holter, event recorders, loop recorders, all these things. So I would like to highlight what we do in our workup in syncope patients. So in a tertiary care center, we come across a lot of syncope patients. It's many times they go to the neurologist because something related to consciousness. But unfortunately, very, very rarely the neurological cause will produce. If you apply the true definition of syncope, that is transient loss of consciousness with a prompt recovery within few minutes, less than a minute, without then patient able to carry out his work. If you apply the true definition of syncope, rarely any neurological cause. But the patient something related to consciousness, they will land up to the neurologist, getting CT, MRI, all the investigations. So then the neurologist will refer the cardiologist to rule out any cardiac problem. So what we do is, we'll go to the history. Again, it's very, very important to come to the diagnosis. Lot of common varieties like neurocardiogenic syncope, vasovagal syncope, situational syncopes are there. So history gives us lot of idea. But the thing is, mortality related to cardiac thing is very high. If it is due to vasovagal, then the mortality is a benign thing. There is no much increase in mortality. But if it is due to cardiac, like complete heart block or ventricular tachycardia, tachycardia or bradyarrhythmia, mortality is very high. So we should, as a cardiologist, as an electrophysiologist, we would like to rule out any cardiac cause for this syncope, any lethal thing. So if it is those things are ruled out, then like long QT syndrome, transient polymorphic VT, present with syncope. Patient go to the neurologist, get anti-epileptic medications, recurrent syncopes. So if one anti-epileptic is not working, they will put a 2 anti-epileptic drug. And ultimately patient may be having the cardiac problem. So we do tentative test, we use hemodynamic data, we record both ECG and blood pressure. Doing syncope, we document what is the pulse and what is the heart rate and the BP. Based on that, we categorize the patient and we'll give advice treatment accordingly. There are special pacemakers are available to take care of syncope also, those who are refractory, syncope recurrent episodes, quality of life is affected. We have special pacemakers to prevent that. And the other thing is, elderly patient, forgotten thing is carotid sinus syncope. They have the carotid sinus hypersensitivity. If you press the carotid by turning the neck or suddenly moving the neck or even without that also, suddenly goes into the asystole. These patients, elderly patients, they fall repeatedly. They